Alright, so today I guess I'm gonna continue this little bit of series about discussing ponds versus the cisterns. Okay, now we have all these cisterns out there. I've checked them out today and the prices are like, whoa, skyrocketing through the roof. I mean, you can pay $5,000 for a cistern easily. And so I'm like, well, that's wrong. We're not going to do that. That is not appropriate for this non-consumptive, I'll call us a non-consumptive era, a non-consumptive species. You know, that's our goal, is to be non-consumptive. And running out and getting $5,000 or $15,000cistern that's plastic, that or steel or whatever, that's an eyesore, is not really the answer. I've already done this a little bit. I've gotten that barrel thing. We know it's like a steel thing that the cows drink out of. I've done that before. You order those for like $300 to $500, and it works. But I don't know, there are better ways. Okay, because the reason I'm saying there are better ways is because that does not support really any life. It doesn't support life. And we're looking for something that can support life, animal life, local animal life as well. So we're just not just, oh, greedy me, I need the water. I need the water, you know, in a big bowl. And nobody can have it. Nobody can touch that water. No, we want to share that water with frogs. If it's water that comes from our rooftops, or a canopy system as well. I want to talk about the canopy systems. You can also use any lots of canopies out there, nettings that go off into cistern styles. Now, instead of cisterns, I would love the word pond immediately. We'll just go use straight into ponds. But we're all panicked on evaporation. Now, we have to avoid evaporations, we have duckweed, we have reed plants, we have all kinds of plants that avoid evaporation. You have lily pads, all of these things. So the more plants that cover that water, the less evaporation you will have. You have to look at the water as evaporating where it is just the water and the sunshine. Okay, now if you can also cover that pond with something, you can cover it with material, a shade tree that doesn't drop a lot. If you cover that pond also, you lower that transpiration, that temperature, and that evaporation rate, it reduces also. So they have this, they're advertising it a lot, those balls, they put these little balls, these black balls, all over these aquifers down in Southern California, and they're just filling them up with all these black balls to cover the surface, to save the water from escaping. Okay, so, you know, there are these techniques that we're using in these modern water supplies. But if we can use the same water, it would be better to have any large body of water that you're making instead of a nasty cistern, like a septic, instead of something like that, let it be something that's equitable and that we share with wildlife and the rest of the environment. You know, it's only fair. You know, instead of just being humans on this stage by ourselves, we are humans with other animals. We have snakes that we have to give water. I know when I was in New Mexico, immediately my little tiny pond, there are snakes. Oh, they were just happy as heck. And it became their new place to hunt and you know, have a great life. So you just all of a sudden you just bring in birds and snakes, all kinds of things. They just can't stand it, and you're getting dragonflies, and you get all kinds of things, and the world, the ecosystem, the small little ecosystem that we are, starts to create again. You know, if we just keep killing it and killing it and killing it, going just me on planet Earth, human, and it's just me in my cistern tank, and it's just me over here in this house, and if we keep killing nature. You know, it's really just going to be that situation and it's not going to be very pleasant, if at all, if we even survive living without that mini specie. So so back to the pond, to avoid us, so with any of these eco villages, eco communities, we can always build a pond for each little house, or a major pond, and that major pond, you know, instead of being just completely covered. I know evaporation rates in the desert are ridiculous. They, even here in the Bay Area, we're talking a quarter of an inch a week, or even more. I don't know. I don't know the statistics on it. I just know it does go. It does go quickly, and so there's all these like, well, how do you stop it? Well, fill up that water with these plants, and so that's wonderful. That's a wonderful way. And now we're talking about that being, well, wait, maybe I don't have enough water. Well, there are water truck people, and they do deliver water, and so you can have your pond or your reservoir refilled, no matter where you live. So there's always that availability. If you can't wait till monsoon season and have everything filled up for the full year, then that's okay. You still have water truck people that help. So you have that them, you know, just dazzle out to your property, and they fill up that pond. So this is what we're talking about, is making ponds principal over having a cistern system. Now, if you want to convert, now you say, well, that's just the rainwater, and now I want to convert it back into the house, and I don't want algae in the house. That's very simple, and you go through the steps of thinner and thinner and thinner with the reed system and the gravels, and a little bit of volcanic pumice and sand. And after all of that, you have that clear water again. So we're looking at a charcoal. So you're looking at the getting that back to clear water. So you go from the green, and you can have the algae bloom and all of that go on, but later on you have the clear water again to refeed back into the house. So this was just I don't know. I just think it's imperative that instead of us being selfish and getting tanks, instead we get ponds instead. Build ponds, and that means ponds that are just dug into the ground. A regular pond, and they can be deep, or they like a swimming pool, or they can be not so deep, but better like a swimming pool, I think, because then you have much more supply. What is it? A standard swimming pool is 18,000 gallons of water. That's a lot of water. And Anyway, I know I didn't mean to harp on this. I know you all are experts on it as well. Everybody's starting to know it's that easy, it's that simple. I don't know. I just wanted to steer away from, because I know even that with the cob cisterns, people are building cob construction cisterns, which is fine, which is okay, and that water's not going to, as soon as you cap it, it's not going to go anywhere. It's not going to evaporate. But it does seem like if you have a little bit of rain, if you have that availability, go for it and actually have a pond also. If you have a little water supply, go for it. Now, instead of the cisterns. But okay, so what? I don't sound like a babbler here. We are talking about rainwater catchment. Now, rainwater catchment, if you take the rainwater, there's two ways. There's the canopy version, where you take take canvas or netting, and you put it on the four poles, and you tilt it a little bit, and then all of a sudden you have water that just rushes into a tank, into your swimming pool, into your pond. So you have that water that goes right through. And that happens especially in rainy times. It'll just fill up. Now, and if you get a good surface, and I mean a good surface, if you have a big enough land, if you have 20 by 50 feet surface, you're going to have a huge bunch of water refilled and refilled and refilled again and again. Another way, if you don't want to be extravagant, if you don't want to have anything up on posts, you don't want to pay for tenting or that canvassing, because I did read it was about $200-$250 per 100 yards of just the single, they call it duck, the single duck weave. There was a good company that had it, and that was for 5 feet. So you'd have to sew it in the middle, and then you would get a good size. However, with that, there's still another way, and that's just on the ground itself. You can always catch water on the ground if you have a large enough property. As soon as you slope the ground just a little, you have just a raked stage. Think of a raked stage like in Russia. You have a raked stage of soil. And that's just, it could be your regular soil, your desert soil, whatever kind of soil you have. And if you are wise and cool, you would also have plants there. And those plants keep that dirt in place. So on your raked stage, so when the rains show up, it doesn't wash all the dirt into the gully. Okay, so it's just a simple rectangle system. Or I'll just stick with a simple rectangle system for your mind's eye. And the water trickles down into the gully just like it's a roof. You look at it just like it's your regular roof up there. A large roof, but it's on the ground. And so that water trickles into the gutter. And then once it goes into the gutter, it goes into a pond. So you have that dantariantaria happen. Now, better if you plant that area with succulents or some type of plants that are very shallow rooted, very tiny shallow rooted, that don't really need maintenance, and they can withstand drought. Okay, and so when it all of a sudden, and can handle the no shade environment. Okay, so they're there and they're on this slope waiting. And even if you get rain only once a year and it's only 9 inches of rain or 11 inches of rain like you get in Alamogordo area of New Mexico, if you're getting rain that is that minimal, you can still prosper from that moment. You can still salvage that whole area, plus your rooftop. So if you have a good enough property, you can have that area and your rooftop, and they go and they feed the pond. So that's quite a collection. I'm really thinking my little place that I had in New Mexico was about 3,000 gallons during the monsoon season of collection. I didn't even collect that much, but when I was counting it out, it looked like 3,000 gallons with how many times I had refilled again and again the tank, okay? Because, yeah, once the tank gets full, it just keeps spilling over. And anyway, so I've had, and there's lots of smart people out there. They'll go into the gullies of hillsides along the streets and during big storms, and they collect water and they'll put it right into their trucks. They used to do that in Alaska where I lived. They put a large tube, a regular tube like that goes out the back of your washing machine, and that tube, they use it as a capture tube, and it fills with water as it's rushing down. It could be snow runoff. It can be rain runoff. It can be all kinds of runoff. But it fills up whatever tank you have in your vehicle really quickly. So that's another way. And it's free. If it's just on the city street gully, that's pretty free. So, anyway, so that was it. But I'm really, really, really pushing towards the frogs and the dragonflies and the wild birds, the flying over, the ducks, the geese. Let's, you know, try to recreate, you know, this is the nature earth that we were brought into. Let's keep it going, you know, instead of just being the spread of human and gravel and house. Human gravel and house is just inappropriate. You know, it's just not fair.